now the pressure is on me, you know, to speak English as well. She speaks sweet Thai, okay? พี่น้องครับผมขออนุญาตอาทิตย์นี้ผมจะเทศนาเป็นภาษาอังกฤษเนาะเพราะว่าเรามีเครื่องแปลไม่พอนะครับเพราะฉะนั้นขออนุญาตคนไทยนะฮะว่าอาจจะถ้าต้องการเครื่องฟังเครื่องแปลนะครับเครื่องแปลเดี๋ยวสามารถที่จะแปลข้างหลังได้เนาะนะครับ if you ต้องการนะครับเชิญข้างหลังได้เลย so I just told my Thai congregants that I'm going to be preaching in Thai I mean in English today sorry in 10 years of Grey City I've never preached an English sermon here okay so this will be your first timeAnd it's because we don't have enough translation device for you guys from Great City. So we're going to be doing something we have never done before, okay, at Great City. That means to hear me preach a sermon in English, okay? Since the beginning of Great City, we have picked 10 Psalms a year to go through. So this year we're actually going to go through Psalm 81 to 90.Okay, so I have to stay alive until I finish 150. All right. Nakap. So today we're going to look at Psalm 88. So if you have your Bibles, you know, so let me go ahead and read that Psalm 88 to you and then pray for it. Okay. Psalm 88. This is God's word. O Lord.God of my salvation, I cry out day and night before you. Let my prayer come before you. Incline your ears to my cry, for my soul is full of troubles, and my life draws near to Sheol. I am counted among those who go down to the pit. I am a man who has no strength, like one who set loose among the dead,like the slain that lie in the grave, like those whom you remember no more, for they are cut off from your hand. You have put me in the depths of the pit, in the regions dark and deep. The wrath lies heavy upon me, and you overwhelm me with all your waves. You have caused my companion to shun me. You have made me a horror to them.I'm shut in so that I cannot escape. My eyes grow dim through sorrow. Every day I call upon you, O Lord. I spread out my hands to you. Do you work wonders for the dead? Do the departed rise up to praise you? Is your steadfast love declared in the grave, or your faithfulness in abundance?Are your wonders known to the darkness and your righteousness in the land of forgetfulness? But I, O Lord, cry to you. In the morning, my prayers come before you. O Lord, why do you cast my soul away? Why do you hide your face from me? Afflicted and close to death from my youth up, I suffer your horrors. I'm helpless.Your wrath has swept over me. Your dreadful assault destroy me. They surround me like a flood all day long. They close in on me together. You have caused my beloved and my friends to shun me. My companion have become darkness. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, we come before you this afternoon, O Lord God.And ask you to send your spirit to help us to understand this very difficult and dark psalm. Lord God, would you help us, especially those who are going through very difficult times, to find comfort in this psalm as well. In Jesus' name we pray. When I was a child, I remember going to the zoo one afternoon.With my parents. I was so little at that time. And for some reason at that time, I was running around and I got lost from them. Totally lost. So I cried out, ran around, cried for them, But my parents did not answer. I couldn't find them. I was totally scared and cried more and more. So my question at that dark moment was that, will they hear me, my crying, and will they find me? Will they find me? Brothers and sisters, in times of difficulties, we all cry out to God for help, right? And we were told that God always answers our prayers because he loves us. We are told that. He either said yes or no or may or wait, but he always answers. So we are told. But verse one says, O Lord, God of my salvation, I cry out day and night before you. And verse 9 repeats and says, I call upon you, O Lord, every day. Every day. He cries out to God for help continuously. And the psalmist is really in desperate for relief. Verse 2 says, let my prayer come to you. Incline your ears to my cry. Please, God, listen to me. Listen to me. So the psalmist comes to God and asks him and to hear his plea and to do something about it. In Luke 18, Jesus told his disciples, right, that God is sensitive to like a ceaseless cry to him. Ceaseless cry for help, remember? Saying that he was telling a parable, right? That this king who doesn't really care, but he listens to this old lady who keeps pestering, and finally he hears. But God is not like that. God loves to hear the prayers and loves to answer the prayer for his people. But the rest of the psalm, there was no answer from God. There was no answer. Do you ever feel there's nothing, not a word, like shouting madly into silence? Do you ever feel like that sometimes? Like screaming for help and no one answers. No one answers. How should we as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ respond to such silence? How do we do that? The psalmist is leading us into the depths of his despair as God seems silent to his plea for help. A lot of things we don't know about what follows. We don't know for sure how it ends. The psalm never told us. We don't know if God stepped in to help him or not. We don't know. We don't know if there's relief from suffering for him. We don't know. But let us look first. What is the dimension of the suffering that this psalmist is experiencing? Verse 3, if you take a look at verse 3, it says, my soul is full of trouble. My life draws near to Sheol. The psalmist is really suffering, you know, possibly to the point of death. And verse 4 says, I'm counted among those who go down to the pit. I'm a man who has no strength, like one set loose among the dead, like the slain that lies in the grave, like those whom you remember no more. They are cut off from your hand. It says here that the pit is a deep and dark hole, deep and dark place, perhaps like a mass grave. Have you ever seen in the movies, right? A mass grave that people just throw bodies in there. Some are dead and some are just dying in there. These people in the pit are abandoned there to die. They have no strength to live on. So more specifically, if you take a look at verse 5, verse 5 says that he feels cut off from the hand of God, from the hand of the Lord, and that that God has forsaken him. Verse 14 has the same sentiment. When he asks a series of why questions, Lord, why? Why do you cast my soul away? Why do you hide my face from me, for your face from me? What keeps the psalmist going in the difficult in this difficult life is the assurance that God can call, that he can call out to God, and he knows, the psalmist knows, that he, that God will respond to him. Therefore, he feels that there's no point in living if God doesn't listen and respond to his prayer. He might as well be dead. In fact, if God doesn't listen and respond to his plea, he's like a dead, a living dead. Therefore, the psalmist is pleading and reminding God not to treat him like a dead person in the pit. Don't treat him like those who has been cut off from God's merciful hand. In verse 9 is a picture of the psalmist crying out so much that his eyes grow dim with sorrow. It's full, right? It's like crying, he can't see. The psalmist has been affected by affected and close to death from his youth. And it was a long, long time, you know, a long time. His suffering happened all day long, verse 17. And verse 18 says, his loved ones and his friend abandoned him, shun him. You see, the psalmist's suffering is encompassing, is constant, and is extended. He was abandoned by his friend, and now he faced divine silence and inactivity. When he most needed to hear from God, near him speak, and see him act. No wonder, you know, the final word of this psalm is darkness. It's darkness. It seems like this psalm is totally hopeless psalm. No hope at all. You see, in the theological climate of the church today, the ethos of Psalm 88 would be an unpopular one. Right? It would be an unpopular sermon. If you preach like this out there, it'd be very unpopular. Why? Because many would rather preach a happy sermon that says, come to Jesus and he will fill out your lives with all the good things now. Come to Jesus, follow him, and he will abolish all your troubles today. Choose him, and he will greatly bless us in every way. You see, we would rather preach a sermon like this. However, Psalm 88 cautions us against preaching such a sermon in three ways, you know. Number one, Psalm 88 witnessed the possibility of unrelieved suffering even for believers in this life. Unrelief. You see, in fact, Christians suffer like everyone else, you know, like everyone else, and perhaps more because we are Christians. This makes answered prayer to God to relieve our suffering a bonus, you know, not something owed to us. It's a bonus when he relieves us of our suffering. If God chooses to let us suffer, let our suffering linger, it does not mean he's evil, or he's weak, or he is displeased with us. It doesn't mean that. Second thing it means, Psalm 88, it does, no matter how long it might be, this present order is not final. It's not final. There'll be someday that will be an end to all suffering when Jesus returns for his own. Meanwhile, the lament of Psalm 88 is a proper response. It is a proper response that longs for eternity of new perfect order. In other words, in this world of suffering, we Christians must learn to lament well as we wait for him to return. And third thing, God's real power is displayed not in the removal of suffering, but God's power is displayed through suffering. Through suffering. The suffering that the author experienced is encompassing, is a constant thing that happens to him, and is extended. He's abandoned by his friends and faces divine silence and inactivity. The psalmist continues to pray. He continues to pray to God for his salvation relentlessly. You see, if faith in God is the reliance on God to do what we can never do for ourselves, then prayer is a sign of faith. It is a sign of faith. The psalmist continues to pray and continues to hang on to God as he experiences suffering. Friends and sisters, everybody in this world is impacted by sin and suffering. Everyone. Suffering is all-encompassing. It's constant, and it is extended. Suffering permeates every corner of this world, every aspect of our being, and every relationship that we are part of. Thus, we can say that the longing for the suffering to end of Psalm 88 is the cry of all humanity. It is. Everyone wants to end an end to all of the suffering. And if you're not a Christian, you're sitting here or listening to me at home today, you and I have this in common, right? You and I want to have an end to suffering. And history has clearly shown that the human being cannot do this. We cannot end our own suffering because the primary cause of suffering resides in the human heart. Each one of our hearts has a monster in it. Whenever the monster gets out, somebody gets hurt. Somebody suffers. It's either them or ourselves suffers. Some people don't even try to lock up this monster. We normally call this the so-called bad people of the society. They don't even lock it. But some of us try to lock up this monster, right? By adhering to various religious practices and precepts. But we still hurt one another, don't we? Because in the end, our monster can never be completely caged up. Cannot. We may want to lock up our monster, but sin, which is the cause of all suffering, cannot be caged up, at least not by our own efforts. That is why to have any hope at all, we need someone who can truly bring an end to suffering by dealing with our monster inside of us. But that which we cannot do for ourselves, God is doing for us in the Lord Jesus. Our sinful heart is being changed, not by our own efforts, but by the one who has the power to slay the monster in our heart, which we cannot kill ourselves. So the whole of humanity suffers because everyone has this monster in our hearts. But in addition to this, we as Christians also suffer, you know, in addition to this, for being followers of Jesus Christ. In some countries, Christians are religiously persecuted. Many of you may be sitting here today. In those places, it's illegal to be a Christian. You can go to prison for naming the name of Jesus. In some place, it's illegal to convert to Christianity. Evangelism to certain people group is not allowed. It's against the law. Social sanctions, legal actions, and physical harm could be imposed on converts of Christianity. In some places, Christians are not even allowed to work certain jobs or access a certain, or certain benefits. They're not allowed. We're not allowed. In many cases of suffering for Jesus, there is an end where believers find relief. But often, believers must endure suffering for a long time and even for the rest of their lives. Many. The reality is this. Many Christians, past and present, have suffered for their faith without relief. Without relief. Brothers and sisters, most of us will never suffer like these brothers and sisters. Most of us will never do that. We would never be denied a job or jail or kidnapped or killed because we are Christians. As much as we pray, we must pray for our brothers and sisters who are being persecuted, for God to give them strength to endure this suffering to the end. But even though we may never experience the same magnitude of suffering, let me suggest to you that we experience the same kind of suffering without relief. We do. For one thing, all of the followers of Jesus Christ are called to fight against our sinful heart, against that monster. Often we face suffering of fighting the battle without relief. We face that, right? There's no relief, it seems like, when we fight that monster in our hearts. For men, I know this. The fight against our own lust is endless suffering, right? We understand too well when the Bible talks about committing adultery by looking at a woman and imagining her lustfully. We know it too well. This suffering is constant and endless. Many of us prayed and prayed and prayed, and there may be spurts of time when we can keep it in check. But as soon as we let our guard down, we fall right back into the same temptation. The suffering of this fight is endless. It is endless. And the ending of this fight will end the suffering. You see, for many, fighting the desire to be married is an endless suffering. Right? We have been praying for relief of this suffering, but God is silent. God is silent. The loneliness, the deep desire for intimacy, and the sexual drive is just overwhelming. There seems to be no end to this suffering. You are ready to compromise and give in because ending the fight will end the suffering. There are many other fights against such our sins, you know. To fight against forgiving someone who has wronged us. May even be our own parents who's wronged us. The fight is endless. The fight against having negative thoughts about yourself and about other people. The suffering of this fight is also endless. And ending this fight would end the suffering. Are you tired of suffering caused by the fight to stay faithful to Jesus? I sure am. I'm tired. I was just reminded this past week of how tired to fight a monster in my own heart. Following Jesus is hard, and many abandon him, as in John 6. So Jesus turned to his disciples and asked them, Do you want to go away also? Do you want to go away also? Peter, who is always the first one to speak his mind, answered, Lord, to whom shall we go? To whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. You see, there's no place to go. There's no place to go for those of us who know him. There's no other alternatives. Just like Jesus, just like Peter said. See, the Apostle Paul described God's power in Christian suffering in 2 Corinthians 4, verses 7 to 9. Let me read this for you. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not from us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. Perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. You see, here, God's power that Paul is talking about is not the power of removing suffering from our lives, you know. It is not. But Paul is talking about the greater power of sustaining God's people in the midst of suffering. God's power is not just used to take away suffering and giving us blessings in our lives, but the power from God is given to help us remain faithful in our ongoing lack and in the midst of never-ending suffering. If God can bring us to himself, he surely can preserve us to the end, even in the midst of severe and endless suffering. These are the true miracles of the gospel of Jesus Christ, you know. Not that he gave us whatever we want, but he empowered us to go through our suffering. We see clearly that the psalmist is suffering. But what caused the suffering? So what does a child see when he does not, and how does he feel when his dad spanks him, when his dad is angry with him, when his dad grabs him tight and prevents him from throwing a tantrum? What does a child feel? What does he see when the dad does not allow him to go out with friends? He probably sees that dad is doing bad things to him, you know. Dad is making him suffer. He probably feels fearful, angry, and sad. How can you make me suffer like this? But if the child understands the reality behind his actions, he would know that his dad loves him, and he is taking charge and doing these things to him in order to address some problems. The son does not have a full picture of the problems, and he does not know how his dad is addressing them. Doesn't know. You see, Psalm 88, the psalmist is confessing that God is fully in charge of the suffering that is happening to him. Verse 6 says, you put me in the depths of the pit, in the region of dark and deep. Verse 7 says, your wrath lies heavy upon me, and you overwhelm me with all your waves. Verse 8, you have caused my companion to shun me. You have made me a horror to them. Verse 15, afflicted and close to death from my youth up, I suffer your terror. I'm helpless. Verse 16, your wrath has swept over me. Your dreadful assault destroyed me. Verse 18, you have caused my beloved and my friend to shun me. My companion become darkness. You see, the psalmist acknowledged that God is the sovereign one over all things, including his own suffering. You see, when we suffer, either God is in charge or he's not, right? And guess what? It would be unsettling if God is not sovereign over our suffering. If God is not a sovereign one, we could never be sure, if that's the case, that this will ever end. It will ever turn out well. We can never really console one another that in the end, all will be well, isn't it? But if God is sovereign, and if he's in charge, two things we can be sure, you know. Number one, we can be sure that our suffering is not in vain. There's a purpose for the suffering that God allows, even though we may not often know what it is. And second thing, we can be sure that whatever suffering we face, it will someday end. It will someday end. You see, and this brings me back to the last point of the sermon, the cessation of suffering. How will our suffering ever end? Ever end? The psalmist asks a series of open-ended questions as a plea for God to help him. Number 10, do you work wonders for the dead? Do the departed rise up to praise you? See, the psalmist is asking, if he dies, how can he display God's wonder and rise up to praise him? So God, help me to end my suffering today. That's the rationale. Verse 11, is your steadfast love declared in the grave and your faithfulness in abandon? In this, he reasons, you know, that if he dies, God could not show his steadfast love and his faithfulness through his life. So God, help me to end my suffering today. And verse 12, are your wonders known in the darkness and your righteousness in the land of forgetfulness? In other words, if the psalmist remains in darkness, God will not be able to show his wonders. If he dies, people will not remember God's righteousness. So God, help me to end my suffering today. That was his rationale. You see, this line of reasoning is common today also, you know, that if I suffer, it shows that God is not strong enough to save me. God is not strong enough. So God, save me from my suffering today. But this reasoning is not completely true. It is not. Because on the cross, Jesus experienced abandonment, grief, and suffering greater than the psalmist could ever imagine happening to himself. Jesus also prayed to God to relieve his suffering. There was also an apparent silence. Apparent silence. God cannot take away Jesus' suffering. Therefore, God must be powerless. But that is so untrue, right? Because Jesus' suffering did in no way show that God is weak. On the contrary, in the most powerful way, Jesus suffered on the cross is the answer to the cry to end the suffering of this world and the suffering of God's people. Jesus took the suffering that God orchestrated upon himself. And in the process, Jesus answered this question of the psalmist with a resounding yes. Verse 10, does God work wonders for the dead? Do the departed rise up to praise God? Yes. Jesus died, but God worked wonders from the dead by raising him up, and in his resurrection, God is praised and glorified. Is God's steadfast love and faithfulness declared in the grave? Verse 11. Yes. In Jesus' death, God's love and faithfulness to his people is clearly displayed. Verse 12. Are God's wonders known in darkness and his righteousness in the land of forgetfulness? Yes. In Jesus, dark suffering on the cross, God showed his wonders in the power of the cross to save sinners. And 2,000 years later, since Jesus' death on the cross, people still remember God's righteous act given in Jesus Christ. You see, the psalmist, humanity, and Christians have not been screaming into silence. God heard the cry of to end suffering and has sent Jesus to suffer the ultimate suffering in order to end all suffering for good. Jesus received the penalty for our sin and was abandoned by his Father so that we may receive pardon and become children of the Most High. The process of ending suffering has started for those who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ. For those who trust in the Lord Jesus Christ, we don't have to suffer the ultimate suffering anymore. We don't. And we can look forward to the day when we live for eternity without suffering with Jesus. I want to end by reading to you about Polycarp. Polycarp was a bishop of Smyrna when he was martyred in February of 155 AD. This is an excerpt from the writing of Martyrdom of Polycarp, which I think summarizes well the content of Psalm 88. It says here, all the martyrdoms which God allows to happen, remember that the devout will ascribe all things to his sovereignty, will bless and noble. Who could admire their honor? Who could not admire their honor? Their patience, their love for the Lord. They are whipped to shreds until their veins and arteries were exposed and still endure patiently, while even those who stood by cry for them. By the grace of Christ, they despise all the cruelties of the world, redeeming themselves from eternal punishment by suffering of a single hour. The fire of their savage executioners appeared cool to them because they fixed their eyes on the escape from the eternal unquenchable fire and the good things promised to those who endure, things which ear has not heard, which eyes seen, nor human heart imagined, but were revealed to them by the Lord. We may not be martyrs like Polycarp, brothers and sisters, but our suffering for Jesus is often just as real. Just as real. For many of us, our suffering to stay true to Jesus has been very, very difficult. So, fellow mothers of the Most High, I ask you to together fix our eyes on Jesus and wait for his return to totally end our sufferings. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, this is a difficult psalm to read because it reminds us of the long suffering that we have to endure as your followers in this world, of the fight that you call us to fight against the monster in our heart. But, oh Lord God, there's also hope, and the hope in that The one who has called us to fight this has gone before us already. You have conquered sin and death and therefore suffering. And you await us as you come returns to make this world with no more suffering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.